Hello, I'm Greg Funfgeld, and I'd like to welcome you to this first Bach at Noon concert of the summer of 2020. 2020 is a year that we will remember for a long time. We have never done Bach at Noon on our YouTube channel and via social media, so you are part of a pilot project, and I'm so glad you've joined us. We have three wonderful musicians who are participating today. Sherazad Pantaki, gorgeous soprano, Robin Connie, our principal flute from the Bach Festival Orchestra, and Loretta O'Sullivan, the principal cellist from the Bach Orchestra. We're going to offer you a program of arias from Bach cantatas, a flute sonata that you'll hear about in a few minutes that was thought to be by Bach, but turns out probably not, and some other things that I hope you'll enjoy. Bach at Noon is a series of free concerts that we offer on the second Tuesday of the month, 10 months a year. There are no tickets required, there's no charge to attend, but over these many years, our audience has been very generous with a free will offering. We're giving you an opportunity to make a donation online, or you can send something in the mail. And I'm happy to say that we have a generous friend of the choir who will match every gift we get up to $1,500. So your gift will be doubled. I hope you all consider that. This pandemic has been very hard on the arts and on artists in particular. So your generosity will be much appreciated and helps to make these programs possible. Thank you for considering that. We're going to start this program here in the beautiful St. John's Lutheran Church with two pieces. The first from Cantata 147. It's a beloved chorale that many people know as Jesu Joy of Man's Desiring. And after that, a song by Felix Mendelssohn called Oh for the Wings of a Dove. It's a piece that yearns for quiet and solace and reflection. And I think you'll find it especially poignant in these days. These have been difficult days. 2020 will be a year we remember for a long time. But in the midst of it, music continues to be a place where we find solace and comfort and hope. And in particular, the music of Bach seems to be a place where many people find that. So we hope you enjoy this concert. We hope you'll share it with your friends and family. And we hope you'll join us each month this summer as we bring you Bach at Noon virtually. Thank you. I'm so glad you've joined us for our June Bach at Noon, and we're so pleased to be here in this beautiful sanctuary of St. John's Lutheran Church in the heart of downtown Allentown. We're very grateful to Pastor Brad and to Eric, their director of music, for their kindness and hospitality. I'm joined by three magnificent ladies, Sherry Pantaki, whom you've already heard singing the Mendelssohn, and then flautist Robin Connie, the principal flute of the Bach Festival Orchestra, and our principal cellist, Loretta O'Sullivan. We're so happy to be here together, and we're going to offer you several arias now. This first is from Bach's famous coffee cantata. Bach wrote over 300 sacred cantatas and a couple of dozen secular cantatas, the coffee cantata being perhaps the most famous. It's the story of Herr Schlendrian, a father, raising his daughter Lieschen, and the new rage is coffee. And Lieschen just can't wait to get her hands on a cup of coffee. And Herr Schlendrian thinks this is a terrible thing and forbids her, and basically keeps her in the house, won't let her go out, won't let her shop, won't let her enjoy the company of young suitors. And so at this point in the drama, Lieschen is singing an aria that extols the virtues of coffee, how wonderful it is, how sweet it is, sweeter than Muscatel wine, and this is her great joy, and her father must let her have coffee. It's been such a pleasure to be with these three wonderful women over the last 2 days. And we thought we'd take a little bit of time now to get to know them a bit better and to find out what they've been doing in the middle of this pandemic. We've decided to offer our Bach at Noon concerts this summer virtually on our YouTube channel and via social media. But we've here been practicing and performing using social distancing and being very mindful of one another. But I thought it would be great for you to hear from them each on their own. I'd like to start with Sherry Pantaki, our wonderful soprano soloist. Sherry has sung at the Bach Festival once before and did a Bach at Noon last fall and some other concerts with us. We're so pleased that she's come back. And I thought I'd ask Sherry to tell you a little bit about herself, her background, her studies at Yale, and where her career has taken her recently.
Greg, thank you so much. It's such a pleasure to be here with everybody. This is my first chance to make music with other people since the pandemic began, and it's just been a great, great joy. I can't say how much. I am a soprano born and raised in India, and came to the United States to study and have been here ever since. And early music is my specialty, although I do a number of other pieces as well, and a lot of 20th century works and later oratorios. But my heart truly is in the Baroque, with Bach and Handel, Vivaldi, Monteverdi. Greg asked me to talk a little bit about my education here and my time at Yale University, which was just an immense privilege. About 10 years ago, I had the chance to be part of a program that specializes in sacred music, which is a great love of mine, especially since I sing early music and a lot of oratorio. It's a very special program in which only one quartet is accepted per year for a two-year program. So at any given time in that year, it's just one soprano, one alto, one tenor, one bass accepted. I had the good fortune to be accepted in the same class as a Bach Festival favorite that many of you know, bass baritone Deshaun Burton, a dear friend. What a joy it was for us to be in the same class together. And it's, in fact, brought back memories of doing coffee cantata together. We did an aria from that for this program today. And, you know, just to set a little bit of the scene, it was our first month at Yale. And you know, the famous, wonderful soprano Emma Kirkby was in the audience because she was giving a program there, and Masaki Suzuki, wonderful Japanese conductor of Bach Collegium Japan, was in the audience, and we were asked to put on for a conference a staged version of the Bach Coffee Cantata. And you know, Deshaun, as I'm sure many of you, if you've met him, you know he's one of the kindest, most gentle souls. It was very funny to see him being the stentorian father in the Coffee Cantata, you know, trying to get a handle on this exasperating daughter who, you know, can't be bothered with suitors but just wants to drink coffee all day long. And we had such a good time with that. I played the daughter. It was just a remarkable program, such a privilege to be among such wonderful colleagues. I think that was my favorite part, is just meeting colleagues who have remained such good friends and whom I encounter in the world of music all the time. It was a great opportunity to study with professors who literally wrote the books on the subjects that we were studying, to work with conductors like Masaki Suzuki and Nicholas McGeegan, famous conductors whom I've had the privilege of working with ever since. And it's, you know, being in music isn't always easy, but it is indeed very, very rewarding. It gives you a chance to, on the one hand, be very disciplined and very focused and work very hard, but also enjoy being in the company of excellent musicians and, you know, traveling the world, which I hope we can do one day again very soon. I've had experiences that have ranged from, one of my favorites was singing at the Hollywood Bowl, singing Vivaldi opera arias in a summer concert at the Hollywood Bowl with you step out and there, you know, just 10,000, 15,000 people in the audience, and Monty Python was here. And, you know, I mean, just it's just a wonderful sort of historic place to be a part of. And I've been able to travel to Japan a few times and work with Masaki Suzuki. And next year I have concerts, hopefully, if I hope to take place in Vienna at the Musikverein. So it's I'm very fortunate to have been able to make my career in music. This is a very difficult time, as I'm sure we're all aware, for so many people from so many backgrounds. But it is a very hard time for musicians to have our livelihoods quite literally snatched away. In about 2 days, we lost, I think, engagements probably, you know, at least for 6 months, if not a whole year. And I hope we can get back to that very, very soon. And that's why this event especially has been such a wonderful return to making music with wonderful colleagues and friends.
Thank you so much. Robin, I know, has been teaching a lot on Zoom and other social media, and on the weekends going off hiking, which I've loved hearing about. But Robin, tell us a little bit about your teaching.
Well, it's such a strange time. And once everything stopped and came to a halt, I had to teach all of my college students via Zoom, as well as other students that I have at home. And actually, it's been a great experience because I've wanted to get involved in that genre for quite a while, because I'm hoping to spread the word that I'm teaching online and see people from other countries, other states. It sounds like a great time. I did Moments of Comfort with Greg earlier this summer, and I'm so grateful to be able to play and sing. I'm not singing. With all the people here and to be playing with others, which is, it's really hard to be sometimes by yourself all the time and get very motivated. Aside from a lot of teaching, I'm practicing a lot. I'm gardening, which I usually don't have a chance to do that much of. I have two couples that I'm going hiking with each weekend and discovering new places that are absolutely gorgeous, which I would not normally do. And I'm reading and I'm enjoying my life, even though things have changed quite a bit. I'm always looking for the positive side of why this is happening. Yeah.
Thank you, Robin. And Loretta O'Sullivan, our principal cellist, lives up in New Jersey, North Jersey, and has been involved with a number of different projects. I'll let her tell you a little bit about that.
Well, let's see. When the last concert I played was about the second week in March. It was a chamber music concert, and we filmed it upstate, and we were able to videotape that. And then that was with the Four Nations Ensemble, and it was a violin recital with the violinist there. And then when I came home, I knew I was in for, you know, a long haul, and, you know, saw the cancellations coming in. And, you know, it was, I thought that this would be the time to take off some projects from the back burners. So like Robin, I started practicing. I started, you know, looking at etudes. You know, this is the time to learn that trill or whatever the thing that, you know, that I've never been able to do. So I did that for a while. It's great to play the cello because there's lots of solo repertoire for the instrument. So Bach, definitely. Had a chance to play two movements of Bach for the Moments of Comfort here. And there's also works by Benjamin Britten and Casado, another cellist, wrote sort of in the Spanish style. So I've been working on those. And, you know, even though I haven't been performing the group that I play in, a recording came out of Handel's Lucrezia, and so that came out about 2 weeks ago. And it was great to hear it. It was great to listen to the takes and edit it while, you know, while I was home. And just being home, I don't think I've had dinner with my husband like every day for a long, long time. And I've really been enjoying it. I'm enjoying cooking. It seems like that's like the high point of the day. And it's really good to have a, you know, kind of a regular life going. I live near Manhattan. Edgewater is right on the water. So now that the park is open, I can take walks down to the park and look over at Manhattan, look at the skyline. And with the pollution being so much less, New York just looks beautiful. I mean, it's quiet, and I know so much is going on there. There's so much angst and pain going on over that river, but it looks beautiful, and I'm enjoying those walks. Thanks.
One of the great blessings for me is to have colleagues like these three ladies. And I just thought, as part of our Bach at Noon series this summer, you'd have a little opportunity to get to know them a little bit, to hear from them directly, to learn a little bit about their lives and their pursuits. So I want to thank them all for sharing this with us. And we'll be back in July with another program. Loretta will be here again, Mary Watt, our principal oboist, and Sherry Pontaki will be back with her good friend, Deshaun Burton. They're going to sing a couple of duets and some other music. So we hope to see you in July, and now we'll get back to our program for Bach at Noon in June. Robin and I have played all of the music of J.S. Bach for flute and harpsichord, and those have been wonderful collaborations. Today, we're doing a sonata that's new to both of us. It has been, for a long time, attributed to J.S. Bach, but in fact may have been written by someone else, and Robin will tell you about that now.
As you know, Bach had 20 children. Four of them went into music in one way, shape, or another. Probably the most popular, best-known composer was Carl Philipp Emanuel Bach. This work, and Greg stole a little of my information, was always in the flute repertoire as G minor sonata. So Greg and I actually have not played this because it's actually by C.P.E. Bach. So I think that's a lot of fun that we get to play something that's a little different. And so much of it is like his father, with whom he studied. And I hope you enjoy it. It has three movements: Allegro, Adagio, and Allegro. Thank you.
going to turn now to cantata 61, a cantata that Bach wrote in Weimar in 1714 for the first Sunday in Advent. It's one of his earliest cantatas and a work I love dearly. He's writing using the hymn Nun komm der Heiden Heiland, which was the most famous hymn for Advent at the time. Of course, the first Sunday of Advent is the start of a new church year. So Bach does something very clever here. He sets this hymn in the style of a French overture. An overture, of course, is a curtain raiser on an opera or a ballet. And Bach sets this hymn tune in the context of a French overture as if raising the curtain on a new church year. The libretto is by Erdmann Neumeister, and he was one of the first people who wrote cantatas that added to the biblical texts and the hymn texts free poetry, beautiful poetry, and that's what Sherry's going to be singing in just a moment. The two movements that precede this soprano aria are a tenor aria, the third piece in the cantata, where the voice of the tenor speaks to the church. And he says, come, Jesus, come to your church and bring us a blessed new year. The next movement is a bass voice, which is the voice of Christ. And he's singing the words from the Bible that say, behold, I stand at the door and knock. And anyone who opens the door and lets me in, I will come in and dine with him and he or she with me. It's a Eucharistic image, a beautiful image of the Last Supper. And then the soprano, in response to that, sings what Sherry's going to sing for you now. And the words say, open up my entire heart, open my heart, and let Jesus come in. So it's a response to the movements that have happened before. It's a beautiful duet for soprano and cello, which we'll sing for you now. I hope you enjoy it.
Thank you.
We're going to conclude this Bach at Noon program with a beautiful aria from the St. John Passion, one of Bach's larger choral works. In this aria, the soprano sings to the accompaniment of flute and, of course, cello and organ. And the words talk about, ich folge dir gleichfalls, I will follow you with joyful steps. And so there's kind of an energy in the flute and in the bass line and, of course, in the vocal line that portrays that following. This is early on in the Passion story where Jesus has been taken to the court of Annas before he goes to the court of the high priest Caiaphas. I always like to tell people that Bach's St. John Passion was heard for the first time in the United States in 1888 in Bethlehem, Pennsylvania. It was a performance given by the Bethlehem Choral Union, conducted by J. Fred Wally, who would later become the first conductor of the Bach Choir of Bethlehem. And that group then gave the first performance of the Mass in B minor on March 27, 1900. So it's a wonderful way to connect this history of Bach and Bethlehem, to go back to the St. John Passion and end with this very beautiful aria, Ich folge dir gleichfalls.
Thank you.